Amen. Our next song this morning is Here We Are in Your Presence.
To our congregation as we serve together. And The Bible that we have been presenting over the last several years is the NIV Adventure Bible. And so there's lots of good stuff. And may it provide you with the answers in life. Can we have a prayer, please, for Ben? Heavenly Father, we are so joyful to be able to present this Bible to Ben, knowing that he will let it guide him through his life. Be with him, bless him, protect him, and guide him through all the days. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen.
Thank you, Ben.
Amen. Gloria mentioned this morning, we celebrate All Saints Day today, the first Sunday in November. This is one of the very unique things about the Protestant tradition, because in our tradition, who are the saints? Look around you. You are the saints of Christ. Those who have committed their lives to following Christ in thought, word, and deed. That's the promise we make in our baptism. We are called saints. The Apostle Paul in the New Testament calls us the saints of the church and orders us to follow through what Christ has taught us to do in our daily living. But today we especially recognize those of the saints in our church who have gone on from this life to the next over the past year. We have 7 candles on the communion table today, and these 7 candles represent the lives of 7 saints who have been part of our church family, either within our congregation or our extended church family. Sometimes these are friends or family members of our church family. Sometimes these are members of the congregation. But today we recognize 7 saints, and I'm going to light a candle for each of them, if I can figure out how to use this. There we go. The first saint we remember is Sadie White. We remember Christy Davis. We remember Roberta Simmons. We remember A.J. Zobrist. We remember Joseph Michaelis. We remember Cheryl Gibson. And we remember Lloyd Seebaugh. On the insert on the back part of your bulletin is a responsive prayer that we'll pray together. If you would join me in this responsive prayer. We remember the great ancestors of our faith, from Abraham to Sarah to Paul and Phoebe.
Ancestors of the faith, we remember you.
We remember the prophets and priests, the ministers and teachers who have taught us the way of God.
Teachers of the faith, we remember you.
We lift up the memories of children and grandchildren, brothers and sisters, husbands and wives and parents whose lives ended too soon.
Those close in our heart, we remember you.
We lift up to you, O God, the names of those we have lost from our lives in this past year, knowing that they are with your heart forever. We celebrate these, O God, and lift up many more names in our hearts.
Family of God, we remember you, and we honor you. We know you are with us in the spirit of worship, and you will not be forgotten.
We give thanks, O God, for all who have gone to join with you beyond this life. We trust in the hope of resurrection and the promise of new life in Christ. And know that in our grief and celebration, O God, you are with us through it all, and we are not left alone. In the name of Christ, in whom love lives forever, we pray.
Amen.
Now we go to our final offering.
expository sentence today comes from the New Testament book of Hebrews, from the 13th chapter of Hebrews. Through Christ, let us continually offer to God the sacrifice of praise, that is, the fruit of lips that acknowledge his name. But do not also neglect to do good and share what you have, for such sacrifices are pleasing to God. If the ushers would come forward to gather today's gifts and offerings. come to you in the spirit of thanksgiving, knowing that all we are and all we have is a gift from you. In faith and love, help us to do your will. We are listening, God. Speak your words into the depths of our souls, that we may hear you clearly. We offer to you this day parts of our lives, whether it be at home, work, or school, a percentage, a portion of what you have given to us. Give us the wisdom and insight to understand your will for us. We offer our gifts, a time, our talents, our possessions to you as a true act of faith and worship. Help us to reach out to others as you, our God, have reached out to us. We pray this in your Son's name. Amen.
Amen. Amen.
You may be seated.
Our Old Testament scripture comes from the book of Psalms, Psalms 146, and I'll be reading from the Message. This tells us to experience God's blessing, always praise Him, and always trust Him. Hallelujah! O my soul, praise God. All my life long, I'll praise God, singing songs to my God as long as I live. Don't put your life in the hands of experts who know nothing of life, of salvation life. Mere humans don't have what it takes. When they die, their projects die with them. Instead, get help from the God of Jacob. Put your hope in God and know real blessing. God made sky and soil, sea and all the fish in it. He always does what he does. He defends the wrong, he feeds the hungry. God frees his prisoners. He gives sight to the blind. He lifts up the fallen. God loves good people, protects strangers, takes the side of orphans and widows, but makes short work of the wicked. God's in charge, always. Zion's God is God for good. Hallelujah. In our New Testament reading, is from Mark 12:38-44, and this is when Jesus gives a warning. He continued teaching, "Watch out for the religion scholars that love to walk around in academic gowns, preening in the radiance of public flattery, basking in prominent positions, sitting at the head table every church function, and all the time they are exploiting the weak and helpless. The longer the prayers, the worse they get. But they pay for it in the end." And now Jesus tells us about true giving. Sitting across from the offering box, he was observing how the crowd tossed money in for the collection. Many of the rich were making large contributions. One poor widow came up and put in 2 cents, 2 small coins. Jesus called his disciples over and said, "The truth is that this poor widow gave more to the collection than all the others." May God bless his reading.
Amen.
The puppet script this morning is based on a true story that the writer experienced when she was a little girl. Well, we had Halloween last week. Did you do good on Halloween? Got a lot of candy? Do you know where it is? You still know where it is? Okay, well, that's good. Well, we're looking forward to Thanksgiving. And then before you know it, it'll be Christmas. And it's a time of the year when we see a lot of charities promoting their individual charities. In fact, we've got one we're promoting now, the Penny Project. You probably saw some little piggy banks sitting around. And you're hearing things on TV and radio and billboards about different charities or organizations who are collecting. And you might have gotten something in the mail, you know, from all of them. And you just got to decide if you're going to give to the Salvation Army, you're going to give to the Red Cross, Toys for Tots. You know, what are you going to give to? Penny's Project? You know, we don't know. There's just so many things where you have the opportunity to support. We just have to decide which one we're going to pick.
Yep, and that's not hard for us. We know exactly which one we're going to pick.
Well, good morning, Lillian and Homer. Welcome. And you have found a favorite charity? Have you? What is it?
Yep. We've been going door to door all week, asking people to donate to the Penny Project.
Oh, yeah, the Penny Project. I just mentioned that. You know, that's that collection we give to Haxum for the local food pantry for Christmas gifts for children, right?
Right. We've even put some brand new piggy banks in the Sunday school classes and in the church garden so people can give here too.
I saw them this morning, and that's great. So, how have you done so far?
Not bad. Most people have been on our block have been pretty generous, with few exceptions.
Well, I certainly hope that nobody was rude to you, Homer, when you were collecting.
Well, one guy was. I knocked at the door and his son answered. When the son told his dad what I was there for, the dad threw a quarter at me and told me to get off his porch.
Oh, that's terrible.
I know. I was so mad. I almost walked away without picking up the quarter. But then I thought, well, it's for the kids, so just swallow your pride and pick it up. So I did.
Well, shame on that man, and good for you, Lillian. I hope that was your only unpleasant experience.
There was one other that we almost didn't stop at his house.
Why didn't you want to go there?
Because everyone told us it was haunted. It's a little house that sits way back away from the street. It's surrounded by trees and bushes, so it's really dark and scary back there.
No one had seen a human being go in and out of that place for years. All the neighborhood kids say that it's full of ghosts and witches and vampires.
Oh, for goodness sakes, Homer. Surely you don't believe all that, did you?
No, but still, the place seemed really creepy. And we almost skipped it, even though we had promised Dad to go to every single house in the neighborhood.
But when we remembered the Bible story, Psalms 89.
Right, it says, I will not violate my covenant or alter the word that went forth from my lips. God doesn't like it if you break a promise, you know.
So we gathered every bit of courage that we had and marched up to the front door and knocked.
Oh, well, good for you. And then what happened?
At first, nothing. So we waited a bit and then we knocked again. Still, no one came. We were relieved.
So we decided to leave when, all of a sudden, we heard footsteps. Then the doorknob started to turn, and the door slowly creaked open, and there it was, standing right in front of us.
Ooh, what was standing right in front of you?
A little old lady shriveled up like a raisin, bent over holding herself up with a cane.
Oh.
At first, we thought it might be a witch or something, and my heart kind of jumped in my chest. But then I realized she was just a little old lady, and a pretty poor one, too. You could tell she was poor by the way she dressed and the way her house looked.
And when she asked us what we were doing, we told her we were collecting money for the needy kids so they could have a nice Christmas. She said, just a minute, and disappeared. She was gone quite a long time.
Finally, she came back to the door with a dime in her hand. She said, I'm sorry, but my pension check is late this month. I looked all through the house, and this is all the money I got. Then she handed me that dime. At first, I didn't know what to say.
Yeah, and you know it's something major when we don't know what to say.
Yeah!
Finally, I managed to say, "You're very generous. Thank you so much." And then we left. I've never been so touched by anything in my life as I was when she gave us that dime.
You know, Lily, that's a pretty amazing story. And it's very similar to the Bible passage we just heard.
I know. We thought about the Bible story, too. And after she gave that dime, now whenever Lillian and I see a dime, we call it the widow's mite, and it reminds us of the sweet old lady.
We learned so many lessons that day about humility and generosity and self-sacrifice.
Yeah. So it's worthwhile that we got every different neighborhood this week. No, we're going to do a different neighborhood this week.
That's right. And maybe we'll have another cool story to tell next Sunday.
Let's hope so, but in the meantime, can we say a prayer?
Yep.
Heavenly Father, we thank you for the sacrifice that people made, just like this little old lady who gave the only amount of money she could find in her whole house. We pray, Lord, that when we are asked to give, that you will lay upon our hearts to give as we can and to give gratefully. In your name.
Amen. Thanks, Miss Brenda. Okay, Homer, let's go home and count what we've gotten so far.
Bye, everybody.
Bye. See ya.
If you remain seated, we'll sing together hymn number 382, Be Thou My Vision. Thanksgiving and our offerings. May the words of my mouth and the meditations of all of our hearts be acceptable to you, our Lord, our strength, and our Redeemer. Amen. So the gospel lesson this morning, it's a familiar one, called the widow's mite. That's how it's labeled in my bulletin, or excuse me, in my scripture, my copy of the Bible. The widow's mite. And I have to confess something to you. I was probably about first grade, second grade, when I realized that there was more than one widow in the world. From the time I can recall, the only widow I knew was my great-grandma Jenkins. Grandpa died before I was born. Grandma didn't die until I was in college. How cool is that, to have a great-grandparent until college? But Grandma Jenkins was the only widow I knew when I was a real small child. She was the only woman I knew in my family who didn't have a grandpa with her. So for the longest time, every time I heard the widow's mite story, that's all I could think of was my Grandma Jenkins. There was one problem with that. Grandma Jenkins was not the sweet, virtuous little lady who would put her last two coins in an offering plate. Grandma Jenkins was a little bit feisty. Grandma Jenkins was the one who taught me when I was in first grade to do basic arithmetic by playing blackjack. Add it up to 21. Do the quick math in your head. Don't use your fingers. I can tell how many cards you have. Grandma Jenkins was the one who, upon graduation from high school, I should tell you this, Grandma Jenkins, she had a personality like a 7-foot-tall human being, but she only stood 4'7". Short little lady, big personality, and at high school graduation, she grabbed my necktie and yanked it down like the rope on a bell at a church. That's why I don't wear ties anymore, by the way. And she said, "I want you to know something, young man. No matter how big you think you get, I can always kick you in the shins and bring you down to my height." That was Grandma Jenkins. One of my favorite Grandma Jenkins stories was the bingo card incident of 1993. You know it's going to be an incident when you put a date on it, right? So my brother and I would spend our summer days during summer vacation with Grandma Jenkins at her retirement community, and we would go down to the community room to play bingo with all of the other ladies, as our puppet said, that were shriveled up like raisins. And I just thought that's, you know, how they look at that age. Bingo was the big activity of the week. Everyone looked forward to it. And I didn't realize that all of the old ladies had their own bingo card. Now, they didn't have names on them or anything, but when we got down to the community room that day, Grandma's neighbor had taken the card that she always used, and these two ladies got into it. Grandma walked up to her neighbor and said, "You took my bingo card." And the other lady said, "Marie, we don't have assigned bingo cards." And those two women locked horns like deer, like bucks, how they lock antlers and just won't let go. And I've never seen my grandma behave like that. And finally, she had 50 cents, because that's what it cost to play bingo. She threw down her two coins, her 50 cents on the table. She grabbed my brother and I by our hands, and she said to her neighbor, "We're going to go back to my apartment, and we're going to pray for you." She drug us out of there and took us up to her apartment. I can still see that day. That's what comes to mind when I think of the widow's mite, because I think I can see the widow in our gospel lesson in that same way, a feisty little gal, and I didn't always used to see it that way, because as far back as I can remember in Sunday school, the widow's mite, our gospel lesson today, was always taught something like the Walt Disney version, where we have this poor, adorable, sweet little old lady. Oh, bless her heart, isn't she just adorable? And she has these last two coins, that's all she has, two coins to rub together, that's all she has to her name, and because of her faith and her virtue and her love of God, she walks gently into the temple and places her last two coins into the offering box, and bless her heart, this sweet, sweet woman has given everything she has to the Lord. And that's the way the scripture has been taught for a very long time, that we should emulate her faith, that we should honor and recognize this woman because she gave the last 2 cents that she has to the Lord. And all these other wealthy people, well, they could have given a lot more. They just, you know, gave out of their excess, even if it was a lot more in monetary value. This woman gave more because it was the last of what she has. And we were always taught as kids to honor the sacrifice of this widow. And when I was a child, they would teach that lesson. And then, of course, they would pass the offering baskets, right? Because that's how we do it in the Baptist church. If you set the context for today's reading, though, you see something a little different. But you have to take a step back and look at the whole picture of what Mark is teaching in this chapter of the gospel. Our reading begins in the middle of an event. Jesus is standing at the entrance of the temple. The entrance of the temple, as everybody's coming in for worship, he's standing right there at the door, having a soapbox sort of moment, calling out the evil atrocities of the scribes. Gloria's translation that she read called them the academic religious leadership. Jesus is standing right there as all of the religious leaders are coming in to lead worship in the temple, and he's challenging the authority of the scribes and all the other religious leaders. That happens just a few verses prior to our reading today. The religious leadership sees Jesus as a threat, not just an annoying person, but a real threat, because the people are starting to listen to Jesus. They're starting to follow him. Throngs of people are gathering around to hear Jesus in this soapbox sort of moment. And Jesus, in this scene, has some real serious charges and issues with the scribes in particular. He calls out the scribes for their pretentious and egotistical and deplorable conduct. He says that the scribes are such bad people, they even devour widows' houses. That was one of the charges that he makes. The scribes devour widows' houses. We'll get to that in just a moment. But first, what do we really know about the scribes? Why are they such bad guys? Why is Jesus so upset with them? So in the Jesus world, in the New Testament world, the scribes are part of the religious temple leadership. They are the holders and keepers of Scripture. This is long before every person had their own copy of the Scriptures. You might have one or two sets of scrolls or scriptures for an entire region, and it was the scribes' responsibility to keep those safe and to know them and to interpret them and to teach them. The scribes, they were the interpreters of Scripture. They were the practitioners of scriptural duties. So when you have scriptures about how to make a loan to someone, or scriptures about marriage or divorce licenses, or scriptures about deeds of sale or trusts or wills, it were the scribes who kept track of all this. The scribes issued these legal documents. You could really say they were like church lawyers. They were the ones who literally applied what the Old Testament scriptures had to say regarding matters of law. We call it God's law. That's the first five books of the Bible, called the Torah. That's what the scribes were really in charge of, making sure that God's law was happening amongst the people. And Jesus regularly clashes with these scribes because Jesus challenges their interpretations of God's law. Jesus says things like, "You have seen it written," or "You have heard it said, but I say unto you," which really got under the scribes' skin, because the scribes are saying, "Hey, wait a second, who do you think you are? We're the scribes, we're the keepers of the law." So there's this power struggle between Jesus and the scribes, and it goes on all through Jesus' ministry, and it begins to sway at the point of our reading today. It begins to sway into Jesus' favor. People are now ignoring what the scribes have to say, and they're instead following Jesus, which we know now is a wonderful thing. But at the time, the scribes were very, very concerned about this, to the point where they saw Jesus, like I said, not just as an annoying guy, but as an enemy, a threat to God's people. So in today's scene, Jesus is standing at the entrance of the temple talking to a growing crowd of people about how the scribes don't even really know God's law, and here they profess to teach it, to practice it, to uphold it. According to the gospel, the people are listening with delight. You can see that in verse 37, just one verse prior to our reading today. They're listening with delight. And Jesus says, "Beware of the scribes." And that's where our lesson begins today. Beware of these scribes. They're only in it for recognition. They're only in it for self-glory and social status. They're only in it because they like being in the spotlight and have everybody look at them. They like to have the seat of honor at all the religious functions. They like the reputation of being the holders and the keepers of God's law. And they devour widows' houses. Those poor, sweet widows. What have they got to do with this? This accusation is rooted in something called the temple tax. So in Jesus' day, and prior to Jesus, it was the custom amongst the Israelite and Levite people to pay a temple tax. When you went to church, offering was not optional, you see. Everybody had to pay. The money was used for maintenance and upkeep for the temple, but it also went to the leadership of the temple to use as sort of a discretionary fund as they see fit. It would very very much be like me standing at the entrance of the church with a box. And when you come in on Sunday morning, you better put your offering in right there at the door. That's how it worked in the temple of the Old Testament and into the New Testament. The temple tax was actually prescribed and defined by the law, by the Old Testament. In Exodus 30, verse 13, the temple tax is half a shekel. That's the word of the Lord, according to Exodus. And the scribes knew that. Of course, they're going to enforce that. Temple tax was a flat tax. Some of us really like a flat tax. Flat taxes are great if you've got lots of money. They're not great if you're poor. Because a poor person, rather than paying a percentage of what tiny little money they have to begin with, they're burdened with the same flat tax as everyone else. And that half a shekel or two mites, two little coins, that might be very easy for a wealthy person to pay. Should I pay more than that for coffee on my way to church on Sunday morning, right? But a very poor person, failure to pay the temple tax, it had some consequences. The scribes could actually put a lien on your property. The scribes could foreclose on your home if you didn't pay the temple's tax. The scribes devoured widows' houses if they couldn't pay the temple tax. And what's really sad is they believed they were justified by God's law to do this. If you didn't pay the temple tax, they could take everything you had, and they said Scripture said it was okay. The rubric for the temple tax is clearly defined in Scripture right out of Exodus. The scribes, well, we're just merely enforcing God's law, you know. We're just doing our jobs. That's their position. So what's the big deal here? The big deal is, like I said, lots of very wealthy people, the temple tax is a nominal fee. It's nothing. It's less than what you pay for coffee. How many of those wealthy people could have paid the temple tax on this widow's behalf? How many of those wealthy people could have paid weeks worth of temple tax on this widow's behalf? You see, the poor, without any sense of sacrifice, the wealthy, rather, without any sense of sacrifice, could pay this tax with no challenge at all. Sometimes, we're not always helpful to our brothers and sisters who are in need. That's the case with the wealthy in our scripture reading today. If a widow's house is foreclosed on because she can't pay the temple tax, that means that every person of means in the temple has failed this woman. The temple, the structure itself, the hierarchy, the leadership have failed this woman if it comes to foreclosure. There are certain people God considers to be special and important. Certain people that Scripture tells us hold a very special place in God's heart. These are people who don't have the means or the public authority or stature to stand up for themselves. These are the poor, prisoners, immigrants, orphans, and widows. God commands His people to take care of them because, quite frankly, their lives depend on it. The widow's mite, the other version. Think of it in another way. Because the Jesus I see in our reading today is not praising this widow for her sacrifice or her faithfulness. The Jesus I see in our reading today is fighting back tears and feelings of anger because everyone else who came in ahead of this woman who could have helped her by paying her temple tax for her chose not to. Everyone in a position that could have helped her failed this woman to do. They failed to do so. They failed to help. What if the widow in our story is really more like Grandma Jenkins, a feisty, spirited little gal? Maybe the widow was one whose home was in danger of being foreclosed upon. Maybe she was one of those that Jesus was referencing when he says the scribes devour widows' houses. Maybe the widow had already seen her neighbor's home foreclosed on, and maybe this widow takes the last two coins that she has and marches right into that temple and says, "You scribes, you no good foreclosing scribes, there, take it. That's the last of what I have. I hope you're happy now." Could it have been that way? Could it have been because Jesus looks at this woman and says, "This is faith. This is sacrifice. Nobody else who gave sacrifice like this woman." I don't think her offering is meant to be an example, though, of her faith and virtue. It's an indictment of how she has been neglected by God's own people. It's an indictment of how people who could have helped her chose not to. Those two coins, when they hit the bottom of that offering box, they ring out like a bell, proclaiming the neglect of God's own people towards someone in need. How then shall we give? That's what I call today's sermon. How then shall we give? I read a story some years ago that I think is worth sharing. It's a story of compassion and sharing and giving. A young boy couldn't go on the class field trip because on the day of the field trip, when he arrived at school, he realized he forgot his sack lunch. And the rule is you have to bring your sack lunch if you want to go on the field trip. Lunch won't be provided. Within minutes, all of his classmates, realizing that he wasn't going to get to go, each reached into their own lunch bags and gave the boy something, some little piece of what they had in their own lunches. And within a matter of minutes, that little boy who had forgotten his lunch now had the biggest lunch of everybody. Not only did he get to go on the field trip, but he had an abundance of food to eat that day. And do you know what else? Not a single student went without. Not a single student was hungry. Not a single student had an empty belly at lunchtime because they all shared what they had. There was more than enough for everyone. And I think the question that Jesus challenges us with is, why don't we live our lives that way? It's easy to cast the scribes in our story as bad guys because they're enforcing this odd and obscure law of temple tax, which gives them the right to foreclose on people's houses. But the real bad guys in this story, and I think we'll see more of this in our reading next week, here's a preview for next Sunday, the real bad guys are all the other people who could have very easily tossed in a couple of shekels to pay this widow's tax. All those people who could have helped but didn't. So how then shall we give? How shall we give in a way that honors God? We shall give 10% at church and then we're off the hook, right? God's commandment is to care for the least of these, the poor, the prisoners, the sick, the ill, the immigrants, the orphans, the widows. They're still among us. They're still part of our society. And I believe, as we read in 1 John 3, if you see someone in need, and if you have the means to help them but choose not to, friends, the Spirit of the Lord is not in you. This is a tough teaching, but it's an important teaching. As we go toward the holiday of Thanksgiving, we give with grateful hearts, not because we're giving to a temple tax, not because we're giving a tithe, but because we're giving our love and our compassion to our brothers and sisters in need. For those who have need, God loves us and God provides for us. And the way God does this is through the abundance and generosity of those who have an abundance to begin with. So give with a grateful heart. Give to those in need because you love God and you love your neighbor as yourself. That sounds like a commandment we've heard before. Give is an act of praise. Praise and worship for a God who has blessed you with more than enough, enough to share. This then is how we shall give. Amen.
Amen.
Will you pray with me? Lord, sometimes it's humbling to recognize how blessed we are. Sometimes it's really humbling because even amidst our blessedness, we can still feel like we don't have enough. Forgive us. Forgive us for our moments of selfishness when we can't even see our blessings for want of more. Forgive us for our selfishness when we can't even see the needs of those around us for want of more for ourselves. We live in a country, in a world, where we hoard up for ourselves while others go without. Lord, soften our hearts, open our eyes and ears to the struggles of those in our community, and as we go toward this holiday of Thanksgiving, give us truly humble and thankful hearts, recognizing that you have provided for us not just our daily bread, but bread for tomorrow as well. Give us the courage to be so generous with others in the way that you're so generous with us. We thank you for the lesson of this widow, her faith and her sacrifice, and we pray, Lord, that we might ease the burden of those who only have 2 cents left to their name. We pray this in your Son's name. Amen.
Amen.
If you would stand with me as you're comfortably able, we'll sing together a hymn of response and commitment. It's number 274, Break Thou the Bread of Life. be seated. The gospel tells us that as the risen Christ sat at table with two of his followers, he was made known to them in the breaking of bread. At this table, we invite all who believe in him and who are in fellowship with one another to partake of this, the Lord's Supper. Let us give thanks to our God. Will you pray with me? It is right to give you thanks and praise, Lord. It is right and a good and joyful thing always and everywhere to give thanks to you, Father Almighty, Creator of heaven and earth. Therefore, we praise you, joining our voices with the angels and archangels and with all the company of heaven, who forever sing a hymn to proclaim the glory of your name. Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. Gracious God, in whom we live and move and have our being, we lift our hearts and offer thanks to you for the wonders of the world around us, for humankind and the richness of love, for each new day of forgiveness and grace. And with thanksgiving, we remember the one who was with you from the beginning, through whom all things were made, whose life is the light of the world, and who became flesh and lived among us. For his life and ministry, for his teaching and example, and for his love, we thank you, O God. For his victory on the cross, we thank you, O God. For the hope that comes through his resurrection, we thank you, O God. For the promise that in him all things will be made new, we thank you, O God. And all of God's people said,
Amen.
Amen. The Lord, on the night when he was betrayed, took a loaf of bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, This is my body given for you. Do this in remembrance of me. In the same way, he took the cup also after supper, saying, This cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me. For as often as you eat this bread and drink this cup, we proclaim the Lord's death until he comes. This is the mystery of our faith. Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again. Will you pray with me once more? Grant, O God, that your Holy Spirit may be with us, and that through this bread and cup, set apart for remembrance and thanksgiving, that Christ may come to dwell among us, and through him we may know you, whom to know is life eternal. We pray this as Christ our Savior has taught us, saying, Our Father,
who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
Christ has been sacrificed for us. Therefore, let us celebrate with love and humility.
Thank you.
We start with the bread, the body of Christ, the bread of heaven. Following a celebration of communion, to join hands and sing together the first verse of Blessed Be the Tie That Binds. God's face shine upon you and be gracious to you. May God look upon you with favor and give you peace. Amen.
Amen.